और
Okay,
यूनियन
so
भी।
now to begin with the administration of union territory topic 2 of unit 3. This is the last topic. Now to begin with, what do we understand by these union territory?
Sir, they are not directly controlled by the state government. They are under the purview of the central government.
Yeah, so but why there is a difference? Why there is a union territory and why there are states? That why do we call them union territories?
Because sir, union ke control mein hai these.
So then why don't we call them state?
I don't know,
Because
sir.
all the states are in control of union, right?
सर वो गवर्न गवर्न नहीं होते स्टेट गवर्नमेंट के जैसा वो
मींस आई डोंट गेट इट क्यों गवर्न नहीं होते
मतलब दे आर नॉट रन बाय स्टेट गवर्नमेंट्स सो
या सो देन व्हाई नॉट डिक्लेयर देम अ सेपरेट स्टेट्स ओनली दैट इज व्हाट आई एम आस्किंग So that then they can perform the task of the states. Why they are union territories? So these are the questions that we are concerned with in this topic. How union? What are union territories and how they are administered? Yes, you were.
It's because the power of the public facility and all the union government, like from the center, and as we see in the Delhi. The most of the powers are lies within the Home Ministry and LG. That is why after filing a case petition against PIL against the LG.
No, you're going too ahead. You're going too ahead of this. My question was very basic. I'm asking that why union territories are not states. Why they are called as separate union territories? Because even power in Gujarat, main power lies with the center only. The center can exercise full control over Gujarat. So why union territories are separate? Now, this is the question we will answer in this.
Sir,
so now,
sir.
Yeah.
So I think, क्योंकि जो यूनियन टेरिटरीज थी जब इंडिया का डिवीजन हो रहा था उस टाइम वो बहुत छोटे थे और उनको स्टेट्स में नहीं डिवाइड कर सकते थे बड़े बड़े
Yes. Yes, exactly. So now to understand union territories, we need to look at the historical development of the Union of States in India, how they had evolved. Now we will understand this. And the first go, we need to understand that there was a State Reorganization Commission, SRC. If you remember, we had studied at the beginning of the Constitution, in which we talk about part states in Part A, Part B, Part C, and Part D. So there were these four distinctions that were made and created. Some states fell under Part A, Part B, Part C. And there were 10 parts in Part C states. The territories that fell under Part D was only Andaman and Nicobar Island. Now, State Reorganization Commission was given the task that when the Union of India is formed, how would you like to divide or separate the powers? How would you like to form these territories? Should the territory be separated on the linguistic basis? Should they be separated as per the population or as per the history or the customs of that particular territory and so on? And should they be separated or should they be merged with other parts of the state? So if given the fact that should Part B states be merged with Part A states? Because if we look at these states, in Part A, there would be Assam. In Part C, there would be Ajmer. Now, where is Assam and where is Ajmer? All these states are geographically very distant. And there is no similarity between the cultures also of these different states. So what was the logic of making Part A, B, C states, which were geographically distant from each other, they were also not having or sharing a common cultural affinity and so on and so forth. So State Reorganization Commission in 1956 was given the task of understanding of these states what should be done. So there were three possibilities. The first recommended that we should continue with Part C states as they were, or and we should make them equal to Part A states. So Part A and C states would have the same power. Second was to do nothing and to maintain the status quo. Thirdly was to abolish them as separate entities and merge them. So, you know, remove this A, B, C, and D. We should all merge these small other different territories, which is earlier mentioned Part A, B, and C, and D into one state. And so the nearby state would be merged with the nearby territory. So small states which are part of the union would be merged with the other nearby small states which fall under Part C and Part D. So SRC summed up that separated from each other by longer distance, they have greater economic, linguistic and cultural affinities. So even though they are at different long distances, they have greater economic, linguistic and cultural affinities. So merging these states with the neighboring states would be creating more problems. It would create new problems. So to avoid that, these states were kept as they were. And because of this, the constitution also does not provide for a uniform pattern how to do that. So because in some states there were legislatures, in some there were they were governed by ministries, and some they were given, governed by the advisory councils. Now some of them also they were governed by lieutenant governors, and remaining others were governed by chief commissioners. Now summing up this entire episode or entire debate, the state commission said that the position is that there is a general consensus of opinion that the existing setup of Part C states is unsatisfactory. The solutions suggested by the official representatives of Part C states, namely the constitutional status, which is identical with Part of A states, will only remove the constitutional anomalies. Means by removing the other states and merging them with Part A states, which only provide some kind of convenience to maneuver constitution, to apply constitution. But whereas it would create economical and financial instability administratively, and also these units will be administrative and politically unstable. So the general consensus of the SRC was this. Now, because of the democratic experiment in these states, wherever it has been tried has proved to be more costly than was expected, because to maintain a different sets of government in different territories would also be not very cost effective. The consequences will be undesirable, and the expenditure and finding of resources would also be difficult. Because if we look at Lakshadweep and we look at Andaman and Nicobar, they are economically backwards places. Now, because they are limited by the resources, by population and by certain many other means, because natural resources are not distributed equally. And to merge Andaman and Nicobar with Kerala or with Chennai would be a disaster, because the two cultures are different. It can solve the problem of merging them and taking care of applying of rules and regulations in there, but financially, economically and culturally it would be a disaster. So the organization plan that SRC suggested was only on two categories of units in Indian Union. First, states forming primary constituent units of Indian Union having a constitutional relationship with center on a federal basis, that when the states are created, the states will have only a federal relationship with the center. The center will not intervene in the matters of the state. It will leave the states free to reorganize administration, rules and regulations within their territory. Second, the territories, which we known as union territories, are vital strategic parts. So all these parts are vital. All the union territories are strategically vital places for the Union of India. And this plan was given effect under the 7th Amendment of the Constitution. And the State Reorganization Act 1956 paved the way for this 7th Amendment of the Constitution, through which 7 union territories were created. Now today we have 8 union territories. Which are these 8 union territories? First, Delhi. Second, Andaman and Nicobar Island. Third, the Lakshadweep, Minicoy and Amindivi Islands, which are known as Lakshadweep Islands now. Fourth, Daman and Diu. Fifth, Dadra and Nagar Haveli. Sixth is Puducherry. And seventh is Chandigarh. And eighth one is Jammu and Kashmir. Now, in the Union Territory, there is a special place given to Delhi, because Delhi is a federal capital. Delhi being the national capital, the federal capital, is a special state. Now, Delhi is considered to be a union territory because there is a full-fledged constituent unit of the Indian Union. Even under unitary system of government, even when the power is seated in Delhi, but Delhi administration is different from the main seated power in Delhi. Now, this national capital is under special dispensation. Although they say that because there are special discounts and the taxes and other things are lower in Delhi because of its status of special state. Looking at Delhi, we can compare it with London and Paris, which are perhaps the best example where the greater degree of control of the city administration lies with the municipalities, but the main control lies with the center, because the army, the bureaucrats, the other central authorities, powers lie in Delhi. The position of power, the seat of power, is in Delhi. Now, we have next two union territories listed as islands in Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea. They are not contiguous with any of the state, means they are not landlocked with any of the states of India. They are backward and undeveloped. And they were also the former French and Portuguese colonies. And because of that, they developed a distinct culture of their own. And because of that, a special status is given so that they can protect this culture and affinity of that particular island, or we can say union territory. The constitutional provisions dealing with these union territories attempt to set out the basic pattern of administration for them. Now, this is for the administrative purpose and to provide an ease at administration that union territories were given these four main features, which only pertain to union territories. Which are these four features? First feature is that union territories fall under the administration of the president. Now, president appoints an administrator with a suitable designation, whether lieutenant governor or any other chief commissioner, to provide for the provisions of law and administration of any of these territories. Second point is that the president, if he chooses, can appoint a governor of a state who would serve as the administrator of any of this union territory. So no one special person can also be appointed, but it can also not be appointed, and one governor of a particular state can be given the control of this union territory. Third point is that president may make regulations regarding peace, progress and good governance of union territories. So for example, in the union territories of Andaman and Nicobar and Lakshadweep Islands, such regulations are made by the president, which repeal and amend any existing act dealing with administration in these territories of the island. So it is regulated by the president. President can amend and remove that particular set of law from for managing or administrating that particular union territory. Fourth and the last one is that the parliament is empowered to constitute a high court, which performs the same function for the existing court that is there in the particular state. Now, Parliament provides the law for the Union Territories, and High Court is established under these laws, and these territories remain within the jurisdiction of High Courts. So, the example of Haryana and Punjab, I told you that they share a particular one High Court. So, power is shared between them. Now, we need to understand this Union Territories were special because of their history. Because the history that they shared with the past Bharat or the princely states in India is the reason why they have been given the status of Union Territories. Now, latest to join was Jammu and Kashmir through the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act of 2019, which was passed on 31st October, that Jammu and Kashmir and other part of Ladakh became the Union Territory of India. Now, the constitutional status says that India is a union of states, and the states also of the constitution says the territory of India comprises the territory of the states. So, these are the Union Territories, which are the other territories that are acquired by the states, and because of their special status and because of the special history, because also of the strategic positions, they are understood to be as Union Territories, and the rules and regulations governing them are different. Now, what is the difference here? That out of all the Union Territories, out of all the 8 Union Territories, only 3 Union Territories have elected legislatures and governments. Which are these states? First, Delhi. Second, Jammu and Kashmir. Third, Puducherry. These are the only 3 Union Territories where an elected legislator is allowed. Rest other Union Territories, there is Lieutenant Governors or the administrators of the states that were given. Earlier, Arunachal Pradesh was considered to be a Union Territory. Goa was also considered to be a Union Territory. Himachal Pradesh, Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland, Tripura, they were also considered as Union Territory. But as of now, we have 8 Union Territories, and their administration is controlled by the President, and rules regarding this are made by the President as well as by the Parliament. So with this, we complete the idea of Union Territory. Now, if there is any question regarding this, please ask.
Rest of other than the 3, उनमें कैसे होता है रेगुलेट गवर्नेंस
कौन से 3 में
अपने 3 बोला पुडुचेरी जेएनके एंड दिल्ली
देयर आर इलेक्टेड स्टेट लेजिस्लेचर्स देयर आर देयर नहीं देयर आर इलेक्टेड
उनके अलावा जो है
हां
उनमें कैसे होता है इनके अलावा
दे आर गवर्नड बाय द लेफ्टिनेंट गवर्नर्स अपॉइंटेड बाय द प्रेसिडेंट हु रिमेंस द मैन ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट मैनेजेस दिस रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन एंड President also applies certain special laws over there. So these Union Territories can also be considered as tax haven, because the prices, the taxes are applied over there are lesser, because GST is applied all over India. And the GST that is applied to Union Territories is called UGST. So they are serving as a tax haven also, some discount and special taxation is available over there, so that people are promoted to have some economic freedom over there, because these places were economically backward and politically instable because of their different culture.
Sir, तो ये जो है और तो उनमें कह सकते हैं कि वो ये unitary government है या फिर एक ही आदमी है जो lieutenant governor जो जिसके पास पावर होता है नीचे कुछ होता है इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के नहीं
सी इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर्स होता है देयर आर आल्सो लाइक इन दमन देयर इज आल्सो म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशन
ओके
सो म्युनिसिपल कॉर्पोरेशन टेक्स केयर ऑफ द लोकल एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ द प्लेस बट ओनली द पावर शेयरिंग सिस्टम इज डिफरेंट
ओके
या What else?
चुप रह जा।